Tonight, the family talks. They thought it was their turn. So they invited Day1 to their home in Encino, California, and we talked to them over 3 days. The 22-room Jackson mansion is lavishly decorated and a long way from Gary, Indiana, where Father Joe worked in a steel mill. At different times, most of the 11 Jacksons have lived here. Things are quieter now. Fans no longer clamor outside the gates, and some of the Jacksons have gone their separate ways. But the presence of one family member, Michael, is still clearly felt at this house. The Jacksons spoke with Day1 correspondent, Michelle McQueen.
One thing I wanted to clear up is that we are not feuding like the press have made like we have been doing for the last, I guess, 15 years. We never did.
So they can sell papers.
But ma'am, you know, out of the 9 siblings, 5 of them aren't here.
An important meeting to make. Janet is doing a video, and she's going to take off to Europe.
I had surgery this
so
morning.
Michael's doing what he has to do.
And I left the studio.
Marlon lives in San Diego, and he's under the weather, but he had some important things to do.
LaToya wasn't there either, although no one expected her. She's been saying some very harsh things about her father, Joe, which we had heard he wanted to talk to us about. Even though Michael wasn't there, we were allowed within mere yards of the room in which the gloved one used to sleep before he built his ranch 100 miles away. He's still a part owner of the house, and there is evidence of him all around. But the person who seems to speak for the Jacksons is the third son, Jermaine.
And if we don't get anything else, the fact that they brought us out here from Indiana, 9 kids, drug-free, and we became something. That's the most important thing. If we don't make another dime, that's what they gave us.
They were more than the ideal musical act. They were the ideal family, talented and together. The oldest brother, Jackie, remembers those times.
Around each other like glue at the time, you know, every single day, every hour. Sometimes we got tired of one another, you know, but it was great. Great memories.
You really like being together with your brothers that much?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very much. My brothers were my friends.
The early years were the busiest for the Jackson Five. They were on the road nearly 200 days a year, performing 4 to 5 shows a week. But even when they were home, they sometimes stayed in motels just to maintain the discipline of being on tour. It was all part of the price of stardom, the part the public never saw. When we were growing up, there were so many of us who wanted to be you. We wanted to be the Jacksons, or we wanted to marry one, which is another story.
Which one did you want to marry?
Oh, no way. Forget it.
You're not going to answer.
Who? Were we right? Did we want to be you?
I think my family, we were one of the first successful black families in the entertainment business. I think our life off the stage had a lot to do with that. We were right on magazines and this and that. It always showed photos of my mom and my dad and all of us standing there and what we did at home. So I think kids, you know, they wanted to follow in our footsteps. That's what America was then, you know, young groups and role models and the Jacksons, the Partridge Family.
While the magazine covers showed one thing, family life out of the spotlight was often something else. Joe Jackson had an affair that produced a daughter. Kate Jackson threatened divorce, then changed her mind.
It's hard to talk about, for me to talk about it. So,
anything you want to talk about?
Yeah, love overcomes a divorce. So, there wasn't a divorce.
Let me answer that question.
You had a chance?
No, I guess he answered.
In time, Joe Jackson's role in his children's careers would give people a lot to talk about. But in the early years, all most of us knew was that the former steelworker had somehow gotten his family out of Indiana, groomed for stardom. What do you think was driving your father?
I think at that time, he just wanted to get out of Gary, Indiana, and move on to something different. And he wanted to see all of his kids very successful in life.
And whenever they would do something wrong, Joe didn't whip them all the time, but he'd punish them sometimes. And if it was bad enough, then they would get a punishment with a razor strap or just a spanking on the butt or something like that. But this playing up that he was a very, very, child abuser, that's not true. He was strict, though. That's the way it was back then. I imagine that's the way his folks raised him. That's the way my parents raised me, and I really thank
them
for it.
Yeah, I got a ripping all the time, you know. The teacher at school whipped me, you know. And I come home, told my parents that I got a whipping at school. Then they whipped me, too. So I got a lot of whippings.
I thought it was kind of the hardest on me because I was the oldest one, you know. And when the other kids would get in trouble, he would get on me for it, you know.
Why?
Because I was the oldest, you know. And Reeve and I was the oldest, so he would make sure we kept a close watch over the kids.
And in most cases that I could think of, we weren't allowed to go visit or stay all night with other kids.
Why was that?
Because he didn't have control and didn't know what was going on, didn't know how their parents were, how lenient they may have been, or what they allowed the kids to do.
There's six boys in that house. And, you know, we were rough. It's a lot, and there had to be some order, you know. So I look at where we are now. Look what we have now. Look what we are. Look what we do. It's great. So something was right.
So I think my father, maybe certain family members were more sensitive as to the way he was, but he was not a child abuser or beating us or this. And I mean, that's the term they use, but any black family out there can relate to. If you did something wrong, you got a whipping.
Your son Michael said in a recent interview that he was frightened of you. He says that he was so frightened of you sometimes that he would be sick. Is that true?
Well, I just knew about that when I heard him mention that on TV on Oprah Winfrey show. I didn't know anything about him being sick, but regurgitating. But if he did regurgitate, he regurgitated all the way to the bank, you know.
What do you mean?
I mean, by me being strict with him a little bit, and it made him a superstar, you know, because, look, it just didn't happen on his own, you know. He had to have a beginning. Well, all of them had to have a beginning.
Driven by their father, the group had 23 top 40 songs. On his own, Michael had 25 more and 11 singles that hit number one. His greatest success, of course, was Thriller. That was the best-selling album of all time. When we come back, we'll hear what the Jackson family has to say about Michael's enormous success and about LaToya's charges of sexual abuse.
It's close to midnight. Something evil's lurking in the dark.
Day One continues.
In the 1980s, the public's attention was increasingly turning to Michael Jackson. While he and his sister Janet focused on their music, most of the others began to slow down and raise their own families. But whether or not it was their choice to forego the limelight, many in the family were beginning to feel left behind.
I reach out my hand to you.
1983, the 25th anniversary celebration of Motown Records. At first, Michael said no, he wouldn't be there. Then he said he would, if he could perform solo. So Michael was there with his brothers for three numbers. Then on cue, the brothers left the stage and Michael was on his own.
Don't ring no rules,
Rock historians say this is the moment when Michael's solo career took off. His individual talent now overshadowed the success of his family.
I used to go by Michael's room, and I see on his wall, he's right, I would sell 20 million records on his mirror. I said, you out of your mind? I would tell him that, you know. I said, Michael, you might sell about maybe 7 or, but not 12. He sold 42 million records.
Showed you.
Yeah, he showed me. He sold 42 million records, you know. And it's hard to stop something like that and come back after you got a career like that, you know. Maybe I would have done the same thing, you know.
Were you ever jealous? So it was okay with you when your little brother
perfectly
went out
okay.
front?
Perfectly okay, yeah.
It comes so easy for him. Melody, song, dance. He just lives and knows and loves it. And it's such a natural part of his life. It's easy.
Is it easy for you?
Depends on what I'm doing. Dancing like Michael Jackson, no, it's a nightmare for me.
How do you all feel about Michael grabbing his crotch in those videos?
I don't like that.
Well, Bibi, it's just part of his dancing.
Yeah, but I don't like that.
I don't like it either, but you know, when people were saying Michael was grabbing his crotch, he was not grabbing his crotch at that time. He was putting his hand in his belt and was like this on his side of his face. And after they said he was grabbing his crotch, I don't know. Maybe
he really started grabbing it.
I think it's a feeling, and the music is feeling so good and everything. He just, boom, he just goes for it.
What about those entertainers just get naked on?
That's what I'm feeling. You know, that's what I was getting ready to say. I think it's one of those things they're looking just to say, oh, he did that, or he did that.
It doesn't look nice.
Why do you think Michael has changed his appearance so much?
As far as what?
Cosmetically? Plastic surgery.
Cosmetically?
Mm-hmm.
Well, it is true what he was saying about his skin problem, and I was so happy when he said that, because I always knew he had this problem, and I always said, Michael, why don't you let it be known that you have this skin disorder?
Because they kept saying that he wanted to be white.
I know it's private, but I also knew that it affected him, that people were saying that about
him.
Still
is private, because Michael would have said, I have a skin problem. He would say, oh, he's dying of cancer.
Exactly.
Oh, he has this.
Not to put you on the spot, Jimmy, but didn't you kind of exacerbate the sense that he had intentionally changed his skin color with that song?
That was creative anger.
Lyrics were kind of rough. Once you were made, you changed your shade. Was your color wrong? Could not turn back. It's a known fact. You're too far gone. Reconstructed. Been abducted. Don't know who you are.
Yeah.
Did you feel that way? That he didn't know who he was?
Basically, I felt that he was missing something. He wasn't communicating. And what was very hurting to me was the fact that a bit of the communication thing wasn't where it was. And I wasn't getting to him as soon as I
wanted to. You mean he wasn't
to.
Returning your phone calls?
Well, is it just that he was working on something, and it's really, when you really get down to the bottom of it, it's really not him, it's the people around him.
You were mad enough to write these lyrics, but you changed the lyrics before the song was actually released.
Yeah, because I felt that, I spoke to him, and then I said, Michael, I did this song about you.
So you meant for him to hear this at some point? Hear about the song.
I wanted my phone call returned. Once the song came out, we talked and we spoke and everything. And I said, Michael, we have to talk, because family is very, very important. And I love you. We started together, but I was very upset.
As they grew up, family relationships among the Jacksons were sometimes displaced by business relationships. More and more, Michael's plans didn't include the brothers.